coxinha.
Faith failed not, and when you are converted, strengthen your brethren. So he failed,
police state for nothing.
The bottom line is that everybody was going to fail, but there's a difference in us failing and our faith failing. True faith says, yes, I failed, but I know the answer. And faith is faith that doesn't stop believing. That's the whole key there.
I appreciate that, and I want to share quickly a statement. My dad was a lay minister, and I think from the time I was 6 years old to I was 65 from the church at that medical porch. I traveled with a gospel group, and you're talking about healing. I was told by the year 2000 I would be in a wheelchair. I am fibromyalgia and some neurological damage from wrecks. And I shared how the Lord kept me in that wheelchair so I could sing for Him all those years. And I cannot tell you how many people came up to me that said, nobody understands the pain I live in. And thank you for sharing your testimony, because I know at least there's one person besides Jesus who understands.
Absolutely. He was touched with the vineyard. Absolutely.
So I believe that's the reason I've never been healed, because I've been able to share with people who are hurting that don't have that spoken system that your church offers people and support. I can relate to that and share with that.
Well, thank you. Appreciate that, Betty. This is what this is even while I'm smiling at reading it, because if you're a parent, you know exactly what this person is saying. I was wondering if you could pray for someone to get out of your child's life. That's what I was smiling about what I read. And my son doesn't have a very nice girlfriend, and I always thought to pray for her and change. She says she's a believer, but there's no fruit at all. And I had a lady at church to say to pray her out of her son's life and pray God works on her when she's gone. And I always pray that my children will have godly wives and that they will be good to each other. Well, I smiled at that because there's not a single godly Christian parent that sooner or later their kid didn't bring home astray that you said God somebody. And I can remember, especially with the boys growing up, that I just had to tell them, you're not going to that person's house, and that person is not coming to this house.
And you're not hanging with
them. And if I catch you after school going out with them or hanging with them, we'll have a come to Jesus. But to come back to the question, yes, absolutely. You should pray. If this young lady is not producing godly fruit and is not you think the right person for your son, you can't get involved in it. It's out like his owner or something. You can ask the Lord to move her out of the way. Children to come. We want the grandchildren to come, I should say. So yes, you can let's go to Matthew chapter 13, where we find the parable of the sower. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read what the explanation of the parable is from Scripture, which begins in verse 20. But he who receives the seed, and that's the word of God, into stony places, the same as he who hears the word and with joy receives it, yet he has not root in himself, but endures for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises on the cause of the word, by and by he is offended. Verse 22, he also who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the world, and, now notice what it said, and he becomes unfruitful. That is a change of one state to another. There was fruit that was born, but then that fruit ceased to be. Unfortunately, Doris, you're right in what you say. I don't understand how anyone who has experienced the saving grace of the Lord would ever contemplate going back. But the fact of the matter is, whether it's family pressure, whether it is persecution on the job, whether it is friends that you don't want to give up and they don't follow the Lord and they put pressure, there are a multitude of reasons, unfortunately, why people walk away from the Lord. But you cannot deny what is said. This is the words of Jesus. And he said there are those that they receive the word, but eventually they become unfruitful. But to be unfruitful, you got to be fruitful, which means bearing fruit.
Word. Yeah, I know the word. And when it says receive the word, but is it someone that it says they receive Jesus into their heart and he became for the love and the joy and the peace there?
No, well, that's to say, he is the word. He is the word, Doris. I think that the frustration is when we get our mind up on the human frailties of the flesh and not on the character of our Savior himself, because there's a lot of things people do we don't understand, and there's a lot of actions that they do that's very disappointing.
And you've got, Doris, unfortunately, some people get angry at God. I know instances myself through my almost 70 years on this earth. I can look back at individuals who were faithful followers. Now, they just were short season again, but a grandchild died, and they just could not handle it. Why wouldn't God heal my grandchild?
Sure, well,
that's the way it should be.
That's the way that you say that when you look at the frailties of the human flesh, you need to look at the character of Christ. He is the one that sweeps the house looking for the lost coin. He's the one that leaves the 99 looking for the lost sheep. He's the one that's keeping the Father's house up, getting that half all good and fatted up for the boy to come back home. Our emphasis should not be on why people walk away, but to earnestly look on the Lord and say, God, I don't know why they're doing what they're doing, but I know you are going after them.
And I just appreciate the reading of the path of God, that he's always there. And I just, it's so hard for me to imagine, but I know people
I sense for my sister that she is truly abiding in the vine. There are some Christians that started off, just as this parable says, they started, there was growth in the vine, and then the cares of the world drew them away, and the things of that, and they're not doing what our sister is doing, spending time with the Lord, abiding in the vine. And soon what happens is the life that they have dries up. That person I didn't see turn. But her initial statement was, I can't see how anybody who's facing all of this, because you're still tasting it.
Yeah, but you know, she said something so beautiful in her husband's time of grief over the loss of a child, they turned to the Lord.
Yes, sir, that's right.
And the same, it says that I brought the same deal.
Yeah.
But instead of them abiding in the Lord and turning closer to the Lord,
same testing,
same exact thing, but then it allowed them to a wedge to be driven, and they became angry.
Because so I got to earlier, we talked about Peter and Judas, same situation, different directions.
Got to take a break. We'll be right back. If you have a question, on air at jsm.org. If you want to email, we got some more emails here. Or you can give us a call, 800-342-8430. And the phone lines are open, and we'll do our best to take your call.
Email your questions and comments about today's program to onair@jsm.org.
Thank you. build your kingdom, that you're not too big for God. I mean, Babylon had walls that were 100 feet high, 300 feet wide. They were a self-sufficient city. But I think sometimes we can look so trying to define something so much you miss the message.
Well, you know,
the message is the arrogancy of man.
Yeah.
Will come down.
Absolutely.
And the will of God will be accomplished.
You know, when the handwriting on the wall first appeared, the first thing he did was he didn't call for Daniel, he called for the astrologer, as Dr. Dupree brought up. And then secondly, beginning in verse 17 of that chapter is Daniel's rebuke, and it goes all the way down to verse 25. Daniel openly rebuked him in front of all of the princes and princesses and the glitterati and the wealthy people that were there in this celebration that Belshazzar was having. And you're also reading here about a change in kingdom. The Medes and the Persians now coming up, which is a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. So look at it that way.
Look at verse 20. But when his heart was lifted up, his mind hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne, and they took his glory from him.
Well, he's talking about his grandfather. He's talking about his grandfather.
But the same.
But it's the same spirit. Yeah.
But his grandfather repented.
Yeah. Well, that's what he does. Yeah.
Yeah. His situation does.
Right.
And Daniel says, but you knew all this.
Yeah. And that rebuke, too, was the fact, you, instead of calling for me from the very beginning, you called for his father.
Yeah, exactly.
So, Jane from Florida, you're on the air. Yeah,
just go ahead and put this on.
So you can stop all that. At
least try.
If you go to Daniel, if you
starting the book of Daniel, the latter part of Daniel, when he talks about the different kingdoms. And
okay.
Beginning of chapter 7, on forward.
People have said it for many years that the Antichrist will control the entire world.
But he won't.
But he can't. And if you look at Daniel chapter 11, and beginning in verse 41, that one verse lets us know clearly the Antichrist does not control the entire world. But Daniel 11:41 says, he shall enter into the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape out of his hand, even Edom, Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon.
Now he's using those names, won't be the names.
That's basically modern day Jordan,
exactly.
Modern Saudi Arabia.
But he used the names of countries that was
then. That existed when it was written.
Right.
And these are nations that are right next to the area that the Antichrist is trying to take over.
Yeah, but he won't be able to take it.
It would also have, when the Antichrist tries to destroy Israel, tidings from the north will come. And he's going to have to divert his forces of fight, showing that he will not have...
3.5 mark of the tribulation.
And that will not, that proves that he will not have absolute control of the whole world.
Yeah. See, at that halfway mark, Jay, when he hears tidings out of the east, and these are countries that are, it appears, that are arming themselves, and their armies are gearing up to combat him, he has to go deal with it. But at the same time, in Israel, in Jerusalem, that's the point in time where the two witnesses will appear, and they will prophesy for 3.5 years. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, until the Lord gets through with what he has to say. Their mouths will be shut at the end of 3.5 years, which is the end of the Great Tribulation and the beginning of the Battle of Armageddon. So there's a lot of things there that we have to kind of piece together to look at to give us an idea. But, you know, I will say this, Jay, I don't think that I'm not a prophecy scholar in any shape or fashion at all. But even those who make it a life study, there are still things that they will not know, cannot know, until we get, you know, I can remember some of the greatest prophecy teachers of the 70s and 80s that did not understand, 60s, 70s, I can remember going to prophecy seminars, who could not understand how the Iron Curtain could fall. And they had charts and everything, and they had World War III bombs and rockets and all of that. When in, what was it, 89, we went to bed one night and woke up the next morning, and they were dancing on the Berlin Wall. You know, so there's a lot of things that we don't know and we can't know.
Yeah,
just have to put it into God's hands.
Right, absolutely. Thank you so much for those explanations. And I want to thank Tommy Bates for being here today. He always brightens up the show with that handsome smiley down
there. Well, you'll be smiling big time tomorrow night, so you can watch it in the Wednesday night service. Ron from North Carolina. And by the way, Fuente Ron's got on air at JSM.org. You still have time to get your questions in. If you want us to answer something, Ron from North Carolina. Hello.
Hey, John, how are you doing?
Fine. What can we do for you today?
I am. Thank you for taking my call. Hey, tell me how you doing.
I'm doing good.
Also, my question is, what do y'all think about a pastor that don't let a local minister that's in a church preach, but he said that he can use us, but yet we went to school, we followed God and everything, street people, but he had to use us because instead of him saying it, it's all because of the competition. They don't want the competition.
Well, first of all, we all know, you know, I can't answer a question because I don't know all the intimate details, but there are many people in Family Worship Center that say God's called them to preach, but they're not going to be preaching in Family Worship Center. It's not going to happen because God has not spoken to my heart to let him preach. And that's, you know, as the under-shepherd under the shepherd, we have to use wisdom as to who we let into our pulpits to preach. Could it be a wrong motive of some? Absolutely it could be. I mean, absolutely. But then again, it may not be. So we may not be able to answer emphatically that question, but just because somebody says they're called to preach, and even if they've gone to Bible school, that still doesn't mean they're called to preach, and they can preach. I can't give you any more detail than that. Tommy, you're a pastor, you're over the church. What do you have to say?
I just believe, you know, I was called to preach when I was 16 years old, and it was understanding in our church the pastor preached. If you've got to ask, it's been a great privilege, but that didn't stop me from preaching. We had house prayer meetings, different things in high school, the nursing homes, and the elderly. You proclaim God's word, and if the opportunity, like I said, a man's gift will make room for itself. And I didn't go to that church because I wanted him to allow me to preach, because whether the pastor allowed me to preach or not didn't change my calling. Because so I had to use that calling, maybe not from the pulpit, but wherever I was.
When I started out in ministry, I was an associate pastor where both the husband and wife were preachers. And there was no opportunity to preach, so I was able to teach a Sunday school class. We had a nursing home service, and started a jail ministry. Went to the county jail and expanded to the city jail and the juvenile justice center. If, you know, there are doors that will open for you if you follow the leading of the Lord.
I would answer it this way, the way I look at it. The old saying, cream rises to the top. If a person's really called, they're not going to wait for somebody to invite them. They're going to make themselves available. So if you've got a prison ministry, hey, I'll do that. Or if they've got this, I can help them with that. And that if it's of God, then that will get back to that senior pastor. But just because somebody says they're called to preach, and even if they went to Bible school, doesn't mean that I automatically have to open my pulpit to them. That's just simply the way that it goes. We have to be led by the Spirit whom we allow to stand behind the sacred desk. Thank you, Rod, for calling. Please explain Jude verse 4. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me explain it this way. First of all, you got to know the reason why the book of Jude was written. Jude himself said in verse 3 that his intentions was to write an epistle, but he was to write, his plan was to write a book dealing with salvation along the lines of the book of Romans. But the Holy Spirit divinely stepped in and changed the tone and the tenor and the subject of the book to deal with false teaching that was coming into the church that day. Now, Jude nowhere identifies whether it was asceticism, legalism, Gnosticism, or whatever other isms. He doesn't identify what the teaching was. But the fact of the matter is, from just a few days after the church was established in the book of Acts, apostasy came in, Ananias and Sapphira. And apostasy and false teaching and false teachers have been here ever since. And it will be that way all the way up until the rapture of the church. Unfortunately, that's just a problem that we have to deal with. And so the Holy Spirit moved upon him to identify. That's why he told us that we must earnestly contend for the faith. The faith, the idea is there's only one faith, Christ and him crucified, that we must earnestly contend, which was once delivered. It's been given once. It's given to us right here. Which was once delivered unto the saints, meaning there's no other revelation to come. We have the revelation of God from Genesis to Revelation. There is no ex parte or extra scripture or revelation outside of the Word of God. I've heard preachers on TV say, you won't find this in the Bible, but God told me. No, he didn't. That's just baloney. He didn't. And so he's warning in this whole book. And then he begins in verse 5, he begins to delineate different times in history past, beginning with the angels that threw their lot in with Satan and rebelled against God. He begins to use them. He talks about them and how that rebellion led to their casting out. He deals with Sodom and Gomorrah, the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah, which is homosexuality, those type of things. Then he dealt with the way of Korah. He dealt with Korah's usurping of authority over, trying to usurp authority over Moses, etc. So he goes down all of this, and the whole point is, he's showing us examples. There was apostasy in times past. There's apostasy today, and we are to deal with it. We've got to go today. I hope that answered your question. We'll be back tomorrow. Brother Tommy will be back with us tomorrow morning as well. And, of course, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock Central Time, he will be on the platform of Family Worship Center, and he will be ministering in song and in the Word, and you don't want to miss that. As a matter of fact, I would just tell you right now, call friends and remind them that Pastor Bates will be preaching tomorrow night live on SBN, and that they need to tune in, especially if they're not going to their local church. They should, but if they're not, tell them to tune in to hear, without a doubt, a word from the Lord. We'll be back tomorrow at 10 o'clock. And last of all, please, once again, let me encourage you to keep that in prayer for a speedy healing and a speedy recovery. We love you. God bless.
Email questions and comments about today's program to onair@jsm.org. Be sure to join Francis Weigert on Facebook at facebook.com/Francis Weigert. Archive programs are available at sunlifetv.com. Francis and Friends is a production of the Sun Life Broadcasting Network.
You're watching the Sun Life Broadcasting Network. This is Pastor Gabriel Sparks, and we've got a very special music offer. For those of you that enjoy the music of Sun Life Broadcasting, you need to take advantage of this offer. Featuring several of our singers. The first one, Dear Old Men, Daystar. This is going to be a blessing to you. Randy Knapp's Praise in the Heat of Kings, the Larson Family, here we are. Bob Henderson, Glory, Glory, Hallelujah. And then SLR presents Bob Henderson. Each one of these albums is going to fill your heart home with the presence of Almighty God. Here's what we're doing. Each one of these albums completed in this offer, $45. You need to take advantage of this very special offer. Get to the phone and for this offer, every one of these albums, which are going to be included, will be a blessing. Get to the phone, go online, and get this very special music offer.
Join Family Worship Center pastors as they minister in a city near you.
So many of you enjoyed Mike Lindell, Francis and Friends. and as well as he spoke Sunday night at Family Worship Center, we're making available his autobiography, What Are the Odds from Crack Addict to CEO, for your gift of any size to help SBN. To receive it, you can go online, shopjsm.org, or you can call the numbers on the screen. We would prefer, though, that you go online, shopjsm.org. That will take some of the load off of our operator. So if you were not able to get online the other day, it's now available. Go online, go to the phones, from crack addict to CEO, Mike Lindell's autobiography for a gift of any size to help SBN. We're waiting to hear from you.
Welcome today to the Message of the Cross. This is Evangelist Jimmy Swagger, along with Dave Smith, John Rosenstein, Warren Larson, Sean Murphy, and Joseph Larson, and you. We're just so happy to have you with us that I want you to know. Dave, did you have any meetings coming up?
Yes, today's May 1st, and it doesn't seem possible, but the 18th and 19th will be up in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. Canadian Revival Fire with Lamb Sisters out of Charlotte will be ministering at 9:30 on Saturday. The 18th, I'll be ministering Sunday at 9:30. So if you live in the area of Edmonton, we'd be glad to meet you again, and we're expecting great things.
Good job.
Well, sir, our meeting's coming up at the end of June, so I'll begin announcing it next month.
On the 19th of May, I'll be traveling to Crowley, Louisiana for one service only, with Brother Jerry Doucette of Crossway Fellowship Church. I'll be there for 10:30 a.m., and we hope you'll come and join us. Also, a quick announcement regarding the intensive. Today is the very last day
intensive, that you can register. They tell me that this is the last day, and then close out registration today, and that will help us figure out who's coming and what facilities we need to set up and who we need to prepare for. So if you had thought about the May 6th through the 10th, journeying here and participating in the Book of Ruth with me, we need to get you set up by today. The others are wide open, June 10th through 14th, Dr. Watts, July 8th through 12th, Dr. Jimmy Dupree. Those are still wide open. You can register for those up to about a week before they participate in them. So, in any case, this is it, and we hope that you'll come and join us for the Book of Ruth. Sean?
Yes, sir. This weekend, I'm going to be up in Trenton, Kentucky, at Trenton Sunday Gala with Pastor Mike Dorsey. And that's going to be for three services, meeting on Friday night at 7 p.m., Saturday at 7 p.m., and Sunday morning at 10:45. So it's about an hour, hour and a half outside of Nashville, Tennessee. So if you live in that area, we'd love for you to come out and be with us this weekend.
Georgia, not until the month of June. Okay, my thought is tomorrow. Am I right?
Yes, yes, sir.
And we hope to be addressed in India. The first time we have been able to get Bibles into India. And 11,955 expository study Bibles for India. Then next we'll go to Mexico, 21,000 to Mexico. Then we'll go to Zambia in Africa, 12,500 expository study Bibles. And ladies and gentlemen, I feel that this is, I think it's the most productive missions work in the world today. And I'm just so grateful for each of you to participate. And I was handed a check for $5,000 Sunday night, I guess it was, or Sunday morning, winter, and to go toward Bibles. The folk were from out of town. I'm not acquainted with them, but I'm so grateful for what they did. And so forth. And so be praying about it because it's extremely important. Once again, 11,955 Bibles for India, Mexico, 21,000, Zambia, 12,500. And that's tomorrow. And Joseph and Dale and myself will start it off at 5 o'clock a.m. in the morning. So, and I'm asking you, everyone, to participate as you can. John, do you have any update on Israel?
Yes, sir. Four things developed, of course, last night. Some of them are a continuation of existing things. But the first thing is this: President Joe Biden is talking about the possibility of welcoming some of the Gazians into the United States as refugees, those that have relationships with family here in the U.S. And there's an estimated 30 or 40,000 that could be part of that. So there is concern there because, again,
where are those people going to go?
They will be considered refugees in the United States. They'll be given housing assistance and a pathway to citizenship.
What about all the housing assistance that's been taken up by the southern border?
Well, Joe Biden, no, no, I'm talking about housing assistance here in the United States. He's going to bring them over as refugees.
I know.
Yeah.
I understand, but still.
Well, we'll keep taking more money. We've got a $34.5 trillion deficit right now, with higher interest rates making it more expensive to fund that debt. In fact, about a third of the money that the government collects from our taxes goes to pay interest on the existing debt that we have.
Well, if they bring in 40,000 or whatever you said, that's just a start.
That's just the beginning. But here's the challenge. So many of these individuals may not want to come to the United States. They would like to stay there and see a two-state solution created between Israel and the Palestinian people. But the fact that he's making these offers, we don't know how well they'll be vetted, how well we'll know who these people are coming into the United States really are. We're also watching today, May 1st, and of course that day is significant to the cultural Marxists that exist in our colleges. The protests are escalating across the country with regard to the anti-Israel pro-Hamas. And we're finding this morning riot police stormed the UCLA anti-Israel encampment after the long-term violence. So we're seeing an escalation of their radical behavior coming out. They're finding agitators at these places, Muslim agitators that are paid to stir the people up, Brother Spider, yeah. Especially these ignorant students. Now, last night at Columbia in New York, the police did find a peaceful resolution to taking those individuals that took possession of the Hamilton Hall. And they removed them last night and arrested them. But this is New York. They're not going to get prosecuted, and they're not going to have any charges. So they'll arrest them, they'll bring them to the police station, and they'll turn around and send them right back out to the world without any charges. And that's the challenge. There's no means by which there can be a deterrent or lawfulness to stop these individuals from doing what they're doing. So that's going to increase throughout the country today. You asked me yesterday about LSU, and yes, there were small protests there. They're continuing today, but so far they've been peaceful. Tulane, which has a very large Jewish population of students, also is now beginning to see in New Orleans a large element of protests taking place there. Also, just another point. Anthony Blinken, our Secretary of State, met with Benjamin Netanyahu. They're trying to push towards a hostage deal with the Hamas. Some of the characteristics of that deal is that Israel will not go into the Rafah, which Benjamin Netanyahu will not put up with. They want to go in and finish their destruction of the Hamas military arm and its leadership. But here's the other thought. If they do enter into this, Blinken wants us to have them take a one-year truce. Well, that will give plenty of time for Hamas to rebuild and retain power. So, but although Blinken is asking these things that Netanyahu can't do, he is saying that if the Hamas don't take this, quote, generous offer, that it's their fault, not Israel's fault. But we're playing two sides of the same coin, unfortunately. The Brothers Smart are very concerned as well with the pressure that Israel's receiving, not just here, but we're experiencing on our college campuses. This is going on all over the world.
Yeah.
These protests against Israel, this fight against Israel, several, five European nations now want to recognize coming up with the United Nations. They said this at the World Economic Forum meeting the other day. Palestinian state, well, we don't have the borders negotiated, we don't have the leadership negotiated, yet they want to recognize them as a legitimate state in the United Nations. So we're trying to...
Okay, where is this?
Five European nations.
I know that, but whereabouts in Israel are they going to claim it's a state?
Well, again, if they're claiming the Palestinian state, they'll probably think of places like the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, along with maybe portions of Jerusalem, East Jerusalem as their capital. They didn't define it, so it's just ambiguous.
Well, you know, either way you go, it's going to be trouble.
Well, it's going to be impossible.
Yeah, that's
about Israel now. Another thought. Israel is now getting, Benjamin Netanyahu is getting pressure from his own people. There's an estimated 50% of Israelis that are insisting that he push to get the hostages released. If he does so, then he's going to have to make great compromises as far as his war against Hamas to stop them from their activities.
Yeah.
But Brother Spire, the pressure's there. The world sentiment seems to be opposed to Israel. Those that are in favor of Israel are not getting the messaging now. There's not enough platforms that are promoting it. And the majority of the, well, of course, internationally, we know what's being presented there. It's not what we're presenting on this program or what Fox is presenting here in the United States, as well as other conservative stations.
But you know what we learn now, what the world, what we already mean, what the world thinks of the Lord and Israel and God's word. And they don't think very highly of it.
Either they're ignorant of it, or willfully ignorant of it, but one thing is sure, they don't believe it.
Most of it is ignorance, but if they're fueled by the powers of darkness, the demon spirits are behind this situation.
Scripture says that whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel should shine. We've got to get the word to them.
We want the hostages released, of course we do. But we don't even know how many there are left.
No, we don't. Israel lowered their count, we brought up yesterday, from 40 to 33, so we don't know who's alive or not alive. The Hamas have only released photos of two hostages, and that was last week, so we don't know the condition. We can see, obviously, they have lost significant body weight, indicating that they may not be well nourished, which also concerns us regarding their health and medical care as well for those that might be sick. Brother Swire, the thing the United States should have done from the very beginning is encourage Israel to finish the job they started. By delaying this, the hostages have suffered, the Palestinian people have suffered. Hamas has been now the narrative of support all over the U.S. to colleges, Europe, and other parts of the world. We have allowed this beast to look good instead of making it what it needs.
What is Israel going to exist right there beside these people that have perpetrated terrible atrocities on Israel?
Well, the fact is, the border where they cross over with their little flying machines, by the way, some of those were seen at some of these college campuses, these flying things that have backgrounds. So the people ride on them, the little things that you fly on them, I forget what they call them. But anyway, they fly in like they're on, you know. But the Hamas, when they went into Israel, they were right on the border. That little town that they went into was right on the border. So how do you not live on the border? You gotta somewhere have a border, and people need to live near the border. So the fact is, they attacked a sovereign nation, and they took advantage of the celebration that many Israelis were having on their Shemkat Torah, the celebration at the end of the season, their hot holiday, and they attacked it viciously, and yet no condemnation of the world. They raped, they butchered, they chopped heads off, they poked eyes up with. I don't even want to go into the gruesome details. It was horrific what they did. It went beyond what most people would call a normal battle type situation.
We should overlook that.
The world is. Israel's being called vicious, evil, inhuman, providing inhumanitarian fightings against the Palestinians and things of that nature. They're claiming 34,000 people have been killed. If they were, that's because Hamas is used them as human shields. But we have no way to determine how many Palestinians were killed because Hamas is the one that's quote unquote keeping records of that. We don't know. But the world believes their statistics and their lies.
Well, there is some, it'll be after the rapture of the church, but there is a man that's going to come to the horizon that's going to hold the answers for Israel. And for the Palestinians, whoever they may be, and Israel is going to fall for it because they're desperate.
Notice all the preparation. We have seen this now since 1948, Resolution 181 of the United Nations. Resolution 242 was issued on 1967 after the Six-Day War. Resolution 338 issued. All of those resolutions deal with Israel having secure borders. And when we talk about the idea of peace, instead of shalom, shalal is the word that's used, which is another one for peace that means security. In Daniel chapter 8, verses 25 and 6, he's going to prosper through peace. He's going to promise Israel some type of secure borders, which Israel wants. They want secure borders. They want recognition of being a nation. So they want to dwell peacefully, meaning the cessation of war with their neighbors. But sadly, the scripture says in Psalm 120, when I speak for peace, they are for war. They're going to find themselves entrapped in this truce, this confirming of covenants that the Antichrist is going to make in 9:27. And they're going to fall for that. They're going to let their guard down. And ultimately, the Antichrist is going to then break that covenant in the middle of the week, that trust. And he's going to overtake them, push them into Moab, which is now, of course, modern-day Jordan. And by the way, Jordan refused to accept the leadership of the Hamas. Qatar wants them to be thrown out of Qatar. The Hania and the other two leaders of Hamas, they said they wanted to go to Jordan. The Jordan King Abdullah said, we're not going to take you. So that was good news. So Jordan's not going to receive the individuals that are head of the Hamas. What they should do is have them extradited and arrested and put into the International Criminal Court and in the Court of Israel for crimes against humanity, crimes against Israel, murder and slaughter of innocent civilians.
Yeah, but that's not going to happen.
And then killed.
Yeah.
Right for himself.
Executed.
Yes.
Yeah.
If we're going to allow refugees, Palestinian refugees into this country, how are we going to know that they're not Hamas?
We don't know. That's the challenge because the Palestinians have solidarity with Hamas and the Palestinian Authority. They're chanting on the college campuses, we are Hamas.
But I'll still say that we're maxed out with refugees coming over the southern border. You want to call them refugees. Where are we going to put these people?
They continue to finance it with our tax dollars. Many
states
are
able
to take care of their own. Well, that's why we see the debt increasing. Just today, Joe Biden talked about forgiving student debt that will affect 30-some thousand students. We keep buying people off to buy votes, and this administration, especially our Republicans, are not able to stop this. And they actually have signed off to some of these things in the last negotiation of the finals.
For these people coming in from the South and now the potential coming in from Europe, we're looking at a housing crisis already.
We have been in one, Lauren, and
that's what I'm doing.
What has happened in the last debacle when interest rates were very low, investors bought all the properties. So now it's hard to find a house because investors bought a lot of properties, and it's now cheaper to rent than it is to buy.
Right.
That's the other challenge. When you look at households today, you need to make at least $120,000 a year in income before you can even purchase the average house cost in the United States today. And many folks can't do that.
Right.
So they've been bought out, they're now being rented out. Now, if the government steps in and subsidizes the housing, those investors are going to be happy. That's what happened with Section 8, and that's what happened with other,
There's still the rent there, and no matter how much we subsidize it, the houses are not there.
Brother, sir, I don't know the answer. The answer is, first of all, get rid of this current administration.
I tell you what he's going to do. He's going to put them in high-cost hotels.
They are already doing that.
Yes, I know they are, but they're going to do far more.
Here's a thought.
$500 a night.
Here's a thought. They've done the census. They know how many people live in different houses. What about the idea that I'm saying, if you have a house and you're the only resident in that house, maybe you take one of these refugees on?
That's
a possibility. That has been floated. I'm not saying it's been something that's been discussed on the political level, but I have read concepts of those
right.
that are part of these think tanks. And they introduce ideas to the government, and if that holds true, we could see a total change in the way Americans live.
Yeah, right. And listen, you got an individual that's the president that is stupid enough to...
Evil's a better word.
To propose and demand such stupidity.
Why not those that want all these refugees volunteer their homes to house these people? I don't see that happening.
No, it's not.
They're not bringing them into their houses. It's okay that they trash the borders, trash the border homes, trash the border farms and ranchers, but don't bring them into their house. Let them destroy everybody else's house.
Yeah, that's
ridiculous.
Situation.
And the increase in crime, the increase of lawlessness, the increase that we have seen in this country, drugs coming in, all these things are a result of open borders. Let me ask this question, I'll make it spiritual. Is this in part maybe God's chastisement / judgment to the nation, what we're seeing happening?
I don't know for sure, but I can just add one to the pot here. This was released from Louisiana Department of Education to the school boards and system leaders on Friday, April the 19th. And the U.S. Department of Education, now some of our already caught wind of this, but it'll be news to some of our viewers. On April the 19th, 2024, the U.S. Department of Education released new Title IX rules effective August 1st, 2024, that expands the interpretation of discrimination on the basis of sex to include gender identity and other categories. For example, under the new Title IX rules, schools would be required to allow biological males who identify as females to receive access to women and girls' locker rooms and school restrooms or face sanctions for a rule violation on the basis of sex discrimination. This is your presidency. This is your wonderful administration in the United States of America pushing this through before the next election cycle. To be effective August 1st. It's evil, and it's just another example.
They destroyed women's sports when they get down to it.
Now, thankfully, some states have joined a lawsuit against it beforehand, so we're not going to accept what he's pushed, but it is the agenda, it's clear. It's a sad day.
How would you like for your daughter to be put in something like that?
Well, she's not. But many have children, they have no other choice.
Okay, will that include Christian school?
Well, federal funding is, if you don't accept federal funding as a private school, you're not obligated to follow.
Well, we don't accept it.
Right. It's
never been offered anywhere.
There you go. So thank God for Christian private schools in Texas and states like Florida, Texas, and preferably Louisiana. Of course, we joined the lawsuit.
We did, yes.
With Montana, I think, and other states. Yeah. But anyway, just another example of what you were asking. I don't know. It doesn't answer the question, but I don't think there's truth to it.
Look, yeah, what's been going on in America and all of these things that are coming against us. Things that are just obviously the attack that's taking place on the Word of God. And Christians are going to be persecuted more than they realize. And so the future is something that doesn't stop or change. But I feel we're inspired. God is telling this nation that we've got to wake up and repent.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, he's not going to tolerate either righteous God.
You did ask a while ago, isn't it the spiritual, everything is spiritual. When you get right down
exactly.
To it.
Exactly.
Because nothing happens. God is not aware of it and functions and moves in relationship to what the church is doing. And like what Joseph just read there on his little machine, yes, the Lord is very well aware.
So has he lifted his hand of protection against us?
Oh, yes.
That's the challenge. People don't realize that God doesn't have to do much except lift that hand of protection. Just like when the children of Israel were in the wilderness, he simply lifted the protection and the serpents became to bite. And of course, he made a solution for them, and that was to put the...
I don't think that the Lord sits back and watches nature take its course. I think he's involved in every single thing that takes place.
The rise of evil is... And being overwhelmed by, how shall I say it, enemies is a standard procedure of God chastising his people.
When you read the Word of God, it's obvious.
Yes,
it's
the book of Judges, and just take a quick look. When we start doing everything that we think we can, every man is doing what is right in his own eyes. No one is adhering to the Word of God, a very precious view. What we're seeing is the results, and it hasn't just started the last 5 years.
Right.
Well, it's been going on, I think, in not just the economic portions of our country, but the agricultural portions of our country. The different unusual droughts across the nation.
Whenever the people serve God, or at least there is a majority who do. God blesses those people. Whenever sin is predominant, judgment comes from God.
Yes,
just that simple. And if an individual person, if they won't bless him, serve God, live for him, and draw closer to him, and he'll bless that person. And those that mock him, they're going to find problems. And whenever Israel was on fire for God, no army in the world could defeat them. Whenever they were turning their back on the Lord, a bunch of children could defeat them.
Well, that's why it's worth saying is that, of course, our study the last few weeks has been on the family, and it is a time where, as the Old Testament says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And the strength of America is not the church even, it's not the state, it's not the presidency, it's the family, it's the home. That's the strength of any nation. Or the weakness.
Yes, or the weakness.
There you go.
Blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord, and if we don't serve him, who are we serving? And that's what we're finding here, the God of pleasure, the God of entertainment, the God really that is causing these people to live sinfully. But I know, we've all lived through, I think, the most amazing times, but notice how rapidly things have digressed. In the last 10 years, we have seen, I mean, Lord, you and I are the same age, we're not in the 60s, but going back to the 60s and 70s, we now see such an acceleration of this taking place.
Yeah.
It's almost unheard of. I remember the in the 60s and the issues that we had then, in Vietnam War. I remember what we saw with regard to the black movement that took place in this country, and rightfully so, things that needed to be done. But now we have seen where we're women's rights, and just the fact that my generation virtually saw women's suffrage, you know, and they're even their ability to vote, but now we're seeing that being just decimated with this new Title IX. Women's in sports or
well, some one school here in the last couple of weeks, the girls were not participating in the sports activity because they were allowing some men to claim to be women and they were not. And they just were not participating.
They're getting hurt by this fire in some of these sports. Well, they're getting hurt in a volleyball match. I'll call them. They are a man slammed the ball, spiked it, hit her on the face, and broke her face. They are stronger and better at athletics than women. Now, there might be that one very rare exception where a woman might be able to compete with men, but the majority of them are not in that category. And it's been proven over and over biologically men are stronger than women. And you cannot have this take place on a consistent basis. These women are going to get hurt. But how selfish are these guys, I'll call them, they are these dudes, to put themselves in a position where they're going to harm these women and think they're gaining an advantage over them because
what type of mental disorder or these officials that place a seal of approval?
Well, that's the thing. The officials that run these, let's say you're a referee and you now have to handle an event where there's transgenders. Should they compete or should they morally say, look, I cannot fairly referee this match because it's unevenly matched?
Well, they should not, but at the same time, you have to put through it.
No, I understand, sir. No, that's the challenge of compromise.
Yeah, right. And, but you got officials and these groups on these, serving on these committees, is placing a seal of approval on it. And, it would seem to me that if the school could vote in proper people,
you would think so. You would think so. You know, I've read studies. I was part of an organization years ago that dealt with anabolic steroids and sports-enhancing drugs. We were at the Subjudicial Hearing Committee in 1991 dealing with that subject in professional football. But in their studies that I've read from very well-known doctors, the big complaint is, well, if you have a man that wants to convert to being a woman, you give them female hormones, and you do not give them anything that will enhance their masculinity, but their femininity. Even so, you look at a little child, before a boy even starts producing testosterone at any significant rate in their body, before they even have any significant measurement of it, the boy is still stronger than the girl. I mean, biologically speaking, even without the testosterone being formed. So little children in puberty, before they reach adolescence, are the boys excel above the girls very quickly. And this is something that's just biologically known. We say all of the science, why don't we?
Yeah, good question. All right, Dave, let's read the fourth verse to help you. Fifth chapter of the future.
For you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath.
Refers to the fact that fathers are to raise their children in love and not the opposite.
But bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord.
Trained according to the ways of the Lord, i.e. his word. And Paul didn't have too much to say on that. And but I wonder why he shortened it and abbreviated it.
It's very clear, Brother Swigert, and we can spend a long time here if we wanted to. There is a frustration that parents can put on children that's really what is being talked about, frustrating the child. Religion will frustrate a child relative to a desire for relationship with God and rules and that are out of bounds, that are too strict, that don't let the child learn or grow or even find their own identity as a person. You can be so strict and put a child under your thumb that you frustrate them. They'll not want anything that you offer. When they get out on their own, they won't be what you have tried to force them to be. When I was small,
8:32 p.m.
You didn't talk about your everything small? I was under 6 foot a long time ago. But I was small, and of course my older brother was bigger. He was 3 years older, 4 years older. And he used to we wrestle, you know, like boys do. And he was bigger, stronger, heavier. And he would pin me down on the ground and put his knees over my arms, and I'm just pinned to the ground. I can't move. And then he would start spitting on my forehead. He'd just lean over and start spitting on me up and teasing. And there was absolutely nothing I could do. I just would, you know, I'm fighting and I can't move the weight. That picture, even done in fun or whatever it was, boyish tendencies and brother-on-brother fighting, that is a picture of what parents do to children at times. When they try to control them without administering the love of the Lord and the true knowledge of the Lord relative to religion. And I think this is what that we're talking about. You make that child hate what you represent. I remember driving down the road, and we were just learning about the message of the cross and learning how to operate by grace and not succumb to the idea of rules and laws and that were outlandish and wrong. And I remember driving down I-10 one day, and the Lord spoke to my heart, and I didn't really have a dad growing up. He was never around. He was out. So I didn't really see any example, good or bad, of a dad at all. And so I had to try to take on the role of being a father, not just that, a Christian father, without an example. And the Lord spoke to my heart one day and said, your children will view me as they view you. Your children will view me as they view you. And if I come across as a tyrant, I come across as that person that sits on their shoulders and literally ties them down, giving them no freedom whatsoever, forcing them into a lifestyle or into a thought pattern, that's how they're going to view God, because I'm representing God to them until such time as they are a little bit older. And as we discussed yesterday, then we learn to give them freedom carefully as they show that they can handle that freedom. Let them grow up, make a few mistakes on their own as kids are there, but it's better you make the mistakes when I'm still there.
Kids are very impressionable.
Yeah, and that's what this verse is talking about in my mind. So just don't frustrate your kids. Don't make them hate the God you're trying to possess. Because if they see in you a version of God that's not really displaying the nature and character of God, they won't want it.
Another thing that parents do sometimes is make their kids earn their love. In other words, you've got to get good grades. You've got to perform as an athlete to get any praise from a parent or father who be in that. And what that does, that teaches them that I've got to earn God's love. And a lot of kids become a perfectionist, or they are in the mentality of works. I have to earn.
You could know it's love.
No. Yeah, and that's totally wrong.
You know, it says train up the child in the way that it should go. That word train in the Hebrew is chanak. And it has the idea, first of all, of dedicating, but it also has the idea of introducing them to new things. But then it has the connotation of experience, something that is experienced in its youth. So the idea is when you train them, you're not putting them under unlawful elements to where they are simply learning laws. They are learning things by experience, meaning they have to make decisions. They have to know what is right and wrong. You have to tell them this is right and this is wrong. Give them the freedom to make a choice. And if they do wrong, then of course let them understand there are consequences. But training is not, it's not being a dictator.
It's frustrating.
Yeah. And if we frustrate them in the way that they should go, they're going to rebel, is what's going to happen. I don't know about you, gentlemen, but sometimes I look back and I saw my failures in parenting, of course. It didn't come with an instruction manual.
Yeah.
But one thing I do know is they got to see a little bit of Jesus in me at times. And that little bit of Jesus they saw gave them the desire to want more of that, the grace, the mercy, the help that he gives. And that's what they need to see. As you said, we're also epistles to the world, our lives. You know, if you're at work and your behavior is not comely to the things of God, your workers are going to notice that. And they're going to say, I don't want that. You know, look at you. You're a hypocrite. So we have to be living epistles to what we do. We have to operate and be a demonstration to the world of what living for Christ means. Not miserable, and every time you talk to them, your face is so long and sad and complaining, but that you're joyful, that the Lord is your God, and that you're able to push through and make things work. And they'll see that hope, and they'll want it to.
It said, bring them up, not put them down.
There you go. That's good.
It's a similar progression, too, with husband and wife, where there's command or instructions of wife, and then it turns to the husband about the heart and the nature of the relationship that you to lay your life down and to serve. And this following children obey your parents, but then fathers, this is how you're to treat them. So a child whose father loves them so much that they're trying to show them Christ, that's a father that's much easier to obey than someone who's a dictator in a way. I know with my daughter, she's 3 now, and it's fun to see the instruction as a 3-year-old. To a 3-year-old is much less than it is to a 2-year-old. So my boy's 2, and about 9 times a day, I feel like we're this close to an ER trip all the time. And we are constantly on an emergency room trip.
Oh.
Yeah, something's about to be broke. So the instruction to a 2-year-old is it's big. With my daughter, just now she's almost 4, and you can already see certain instruction is much less frequent than it was.
Right.
And growing through that last year and a half, 2 years or so, where really we started trying to mold her, oftentimes I grab her and tell her, the reason I'm teaching you obedience and the reason I want you to obey quickly and completely is so that when you get older, you can learn to obey God. And she would recite that to me. I said, why are we doing obedience? And she said, so that when I'm older, I can obey God. And I told her, I love you with all my heart, with everything in me, but I'm not perfect. And as much as I love you, I may make mistakes along the way, but I want you to learn obedience, because when you're older, there's a father who loves you more than I ever could. And the instruction he has for your life is perfect. It's beautiful.
Well, I told Donnie that I was not, I was perfect in any of
these. My daughter, I tried singing to her, and she says, stop. She knows I'm not perfect.
That's child abuse.
Text last night from Rachel, my youngest daughter. She's got a little boy, Shiloh, who's 3, it'll be 4 in August. And she told him, she said, now Shiloh, you want to watch something? She said, your mom doesn't, I'm not going to let you watch that. And he thought a moment, he just looked up at her and he said, well, why don't you leave so I can watch it? Everybody but to get a copy of it. This series is moving.
that you understand what we're teaching and what the Word of God gives us, I think it's never too full. This is Jim's way of saying, I'm waiting for your call. Take advantage of this offer.
This is Gabriel Swider, president of Jim Swider Bible College. For over 30 years, JSBC is preparing students for ministry, whether it's pastors or teachers. With the Word of God as the cornerstone of our curriculum, we are preparing students for life-altering experiences. I can promise every prospective student a well-rounded education on this beautiful campus where people are respected and true Christian faith is practiced. As the grandson of Evangelist Jim Swider, I can assure you that your time spent here will result in three things. Number one, an understanding of the message of Jesus Christ and the crucified. Number two, what it means to be thoroughly Pentecostal. And number three, how to apply the Word of God to your everyday life and living.
Jimmy Swider Bible College, spiritually minded, academically sound.
This is the Sunlight Broadcasting Network.
We are back. We'll start with the fifth verse.
Let me bring this up now. This isn't a Greek definition of these two words, but nurture means to take, just generally means to take care of, to feed, and protect. What a picture of a father. Take care of, feed, and protect. That would be a pretty good picture of a good father. Word admonition means to counsel, to warn. And I can't even read my own writing here, but so we get an idea of admonition, to warn, to counsel, to correct. So those are just general definitions. That's not the exact Greek word, but gives us a pretty good picture of a good father.
It includes discipline and instruction.
Yeah. So, and not driving your kids to wrath, anger. Kids get angry sometimes. Any time a parent says no to their child, they're going to get angry. But a lot of times a parent needs to say no. God says no.
Right.
At the time.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's going to hurt you.
Yeah.
So, just some things to think about.
Things that will hurt needs to be forbidden.
If God gets angry because we are hurting ourselves, His anger is different than a parent who is spanking their child, losing their temper while they're spanking their child. That's totally different than the right kind of correction, the right kind of discipline. But God gets angry at sin in our lives. Why? Because we're hurting ourselves.
Yeah.
And He gets upset about that. Why? That's love. That's love.
We do, our generation, I know a lot of, gentle parenting, for our age group and with young kids. It's, gentle parenting, and the truth is the Bible teaches discipline. And the Lord chastens those He loves, and discipline is not the absence of love, it's an expression of love.
Mm-hmm.
It's the evidence that I love you is I'm going to correct you when you're in a wrong direction, because
mm-hmm.
I care enough about you to do so.
Well, one comedian said we lost the American society when the first parent, sometime in the early 90s, came up with the first time out.
Yeah.
Put kids in time out rather than we're sparing the rod, right?
Yeah.
And we're hurting our kid, yeah.
What in the world are you talking about?
Well, every parent knows it's a timeout. It's the way, it's the form of discipline for this last generation. You know, you just go in the corner and you go and let me know whenever you're done.
I never did any timeouts.
No, yeah. That's why you turned out.
Oh, yeah.
Brother, the point is, the Bible says, spare the rod, spoil the child.
That's what it said. Let's address that for just a moment. You get put in jail nowadays for correcting the child.
For spanking the child?
Yeah.
I start collecting and talking about you. I used to teach a marriage and family class at the Bible College, and we dealt with parenting. And I called there are social agencies that deal with abuse of children. And I called and talked to one and said, what do you look for when you have been called out to a home and to examine for abuse? What do you look for? And she gave me a list of 10 things that she looked for in those kind of situations. We've had children in our church taken away from a family years ago because the parents spanked that child. And the parents had to go through counseling. They had to pay for the counseling. They had to go through parenting class. And
how did the authorities run? The authorities were, how did they know that the parents?
Well, if this is how it works. If someone calls up and says that I'm abusing my child, within 48 hours, I think it is, they have to come and investigate. That's the law. And if they find something that they think is abuse, they can pull that child out of your home. Take that child.
Well, I would have never gotten home, because my mother believed in sparing the rod and spoiling the child. And I learned how to forgive the situation.
There are.
I would scream and holler like she was killing me.
There are video cameras all over the place. You go to Walmart and you slap your child. There are video cameras. If it's reported, it has to be investigated, and they will get video cameras, and slapping your child is not a good way to discipline them.
Right. It's the school systems that are involved in these kids. They're giving them knowledge of these things and sense of one daughter, I'll leave her names, of course, is private, but lady close to our ministry, her center's child's off to university, and she came back, and the counselors at the university were teaching her that her parent, who had taught her in the ways of the Lord, was the reason why she had all the problems in her life. And this is common. The parents are the problem. The school system emboldening kids against their parents, and they practice this thing under Karl Marx and under communism, is separating, dividing families, children against parents. But isn't it funny, you can be fined for child abuse, spanking your child, but we can encourage parents to bring their children to get their sex changed, and that's not child abuse. But in fact, it is. Yeah, it's hypocrisy. And
terrible abuse.
Yes. Yeah, it says in the proverb, he that serveth his rod, that word shebet there, was also what a shepherd would hold, would be his staff. It could be a stick, but oftentimes it was a staff. Hated his son, that he that loveth him chastises him. That word masar in the Hebrew has the idea of keeping one on the right path. So the father is a shepherd of the home. When that, just like a sheep, if a shepherd sees a sheep, though, he takes that staff and pushes it back onto the path, giving it correction and direction. Correction always must have proper direction. So you lead, but you also keep them on the path that they are to go. So it's not just beating your child, but the understanding is they need to learn something from that. But you've got to gain their attention first. So sometimes the switch gets their attention. It's like, I've got your attention now. This is the way that you're to go. Now walk in. So we're leading, we're guiding, we're counseling, we're training, we're bringing up with nurtured admonition, not to harm them. We want to bring them to a place that they will be able to stay on the path themselves.
You know, it's a little sheep, a shepherd,
sheep are dumb, and you'll get caught in a red bead, and of course wild animals can kill that sheep for a little bit, and they'll start bleating, not bleeding, but bleating, and the shepherd will find it and retrieve it. This may happen two or three times, and after a period of time, the shepherd, whenever the sheep bleeds, he doesn't go to his rescue, but he doesn't take his eyes off of it. He continues to look at it and make sure that no wild animal is going to cut it down. And then when he finally goes and picks it up, he takes the staff and breaks the arm and then carries it on his shoulder until the arm is healed. And generally then solve the problem with the sheep wandering astray. And God does us the same way.
He has to
break the arm, so to speak, for us to come to our senses. And a child is connected with a girl.
It's a whole lot for the spider. And in every relationship that's mentioned on the you know, always brings in the higher power, which is God. It's life to husband. He says, to do also. So in brother and brother with brother in the Lord, do it in the fear of God. Wives, do it. Submit to your husbands in the fear or honoring the Lord. And he does really does the same thing here with the fathers and the children when he says, bring them up in the admonition and nurture. The relationship will fail. The Lord's not growing. As fathers, our main objective is getting them to experience his presence, experience his
word. Which is all the time.
Knowing this, that we're not the final solution. So as a father, you can run a tight ship. I mean, you can have a home that's subjective and submissive and not be saved and not know the Lord one iota. But what you can't do is bring him to the Lord. And so that is something that he's not gonna leave that motif in the next few verses when he deals with slaves and masters. In fact, in another passage, he'll say, "Master, remember, you have a higher power than yourself." So again, it's failing to bring God into the picture is what is causing so much havoc in our homes.
Now our discipline, God should stay in the kitchen 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I'm sorry, Mark.
No, our disciplinary picture for our kids was if we had the discipline and we tried to keep up with this, but we would send them to their room because their mom would, but she would say, when your dad gets home. So that was always up to me, and if I thought it was worth disciplining, and it's a form of not steering the rod, I sent them to the room, and I would come in, and after I made them think about what was coming, and ask them, do you understand why you're getting spanked, and make them say that to me, and then I'd adjust that attitude adjustment, and when it was all through and done, and tears were falling, and crying was there, I would say, I love you, and this situation is over. It's done. It's forgiven. It's over. So one day I come into the room, I sent one of the kids, I won't mention his name, into the room. I came into the room to administer. He looks up at me and he says, "Dad, I forgive you."
Stab. Stab.
It was over. It was over.
That's a good one.
I'm going to go into the room and he put on the second.
He's going up, and I realized, come in and put on a little protection. So we adjusted that too.
Right.
It's still the process. It's still, you try to
explain
why you don't just beat up on the child or lose your temper.
Right.
My mom, and I think you said this, or Donnie said this about Francis. My mom used to go outside and cut out a willow branch. And she told me later it was so that I could cool down. And it wasn't just
Get off the sofa like that. You know that. You got a scratch and homemade scratch before it's
in. You have to be very, very careful not to do things in heated anger.
A kid, this scripture, don't, what's it say, provoke your children to wrath. That's not the purpose. The purpose is correction and instruction.
We've just about run out of time. Solved all the problems of correction, and this one has, well, it turned out pretty
well. I'd like to mention, I don't have a closer relationship with anybody on the planet. I have father who invested in the rock. The lie is that if we spank our children, they won't love us. But the Bible says the opposite. The Bible says that. The father doesn't love the child if he fails to chase him.
Correct. Thank you for being with us, and God bless you.
Thank you for joining us on today's program.